Welcome to the AC Small Experiments podcast, where we have conversations with University of Groningen instructors to inquire about what they have been testing, tweaking, or trying out in their teaching and learning activities, and what they observed and learned about themselves and their students in the process. Our guest for episode 7 is Stephen Jones, FSE Fellow, postdoctorate in the Bernoulli Institute at the Faculty of Science and Engineering as part of the Artificial Intelligence team. Stephen has a PhD in linguistics, which includes cognitive modeling. His research looks at the interface between formal theories of grammar and models of language in the brain. Our conversation took place on January 29th, 2021, and has been edited for length. In this episode, Stephen shares his strategies for empowering students through empathy and the successes and challenges he has had recently while experimenting with a different type of assessment called specifications grading. This format allowed students to focus on the most important aspect of higher education, the learning. With an emphasis on critical thinking and mastery-based achievement, this was another great example of plagiarism-resistant assessment. Well, thank you so much, Stephen, for being willing to talk to us about your teaching experiences during the pandemic on the podcast. It's really nice to have you here.
Thank you. Yeah, it's great to be here.
Yeah, so I want to jump right in actually to talking about assessment with you, because I know you've been doing some really interesting and innovative things and creative things within the course you just completed actually. And I think it's something that a lot of people would be interested in hearing about. So I'm hoping you could just launch right in and give some details about that.
Okay, yeah, I can do that. So. I had a brand new course, which I was teaching from September, so in Block 1A. And it's a course that I was been hoping to teach since I arrived in Groningen, because although I'm in artificial intelligence, my background is linguistics. And linguistic theory, I think, is important and is useful in understanding language and the brain. So I wanted to be able to start to have a group of students who would understand the way in which I think about language and who might be interested in working with me later on. So I was really lucky. I put forward a course proposal and it was accepted by the program committee, which is great. And then I realized, okay, so you've made your bed, you've now got to lie in it, you've got to come up with the course and deliver the goods. And when I put the course proposal in, it was in those happy days before Corona, when it looked like we had lots of capacity and there was going to be lots of time to think about things. And because of all the other things that were going on with Corona and education, I found out the course was going ahead quite late. So I didn't have a huge amount of time to do the preparation. And I was really conscious that people were learning very rapidly about some of the pitfalls of assessment and some of the problems of the old style ways of learning in the physical environment as we move things online. And what I was particularly struck by were a couple of things. One of them was the feedback that was coming through from students, so the National Student Survey, about the experience of learning in Corona, where it felt like there was this massive pressure of uncertainty on students, that not only did they not have their peer support, they didn't have the university experience that they'd signed up for, and they were having to do things remotely and depend much more on their self-resilience to keep going through the course. Mm-hmm. In that context, the uncertainty that comes around assessment processes can be phenomenal. So the fact you've got this exam, you don't know how you're going to do it, turns into an enormous thing, perhaps bigger in the context of Corona, because so little else is happening. And you've got this enormous pressure and uncertainty. You can work really hard and have a bad day on the exam, and it's like your whole block has just gone because you've got a grade worse than you hoped for. So it felt like that was potentially really demotivating for students, and also that it would be adding to the stress, and potentially they would be learning less because they were enjoying the learning less.
Well, it's a really good point that you're making, thinking from a student perspective. Yeah. And I'm really glad, actually, that we don't use digital proctoring at the University of Groningen, because I've been reading a lot about it, and that actually contributes a lot to the stress of the students. So I think it is important for us to come up with other ways of assessing, if possible, so that it's fraud resistant and the students don't have this feeling like we're monitoring them and thinking that they're going to be cheaters, because that in effect makes them even more stressed, and it isn't helping them do well on an exam, I think, from what I've been reading from student perspective. Yeah.
Students don't want to plagiarize. I genuinely believe students don't want to plagiarize, but students also want to get what they think is a fair result for the work that they've done. And you can see how in a situation where everything has been very difficult and learning hasn't been ideal, how there are opportunities for students who think that a way out of that is to share information during the exam. It's absolutely not the way to do it. It doesn't add anything to anybody. But the contortions that we then go through as the teaching staff to try and make that difficult and try and prevent that get in the way of it being a satisfactory exam experience for anyone. Mm-hmm. And one of my colleagues reported that during an exam, they were dealing with many, many more student queries. So, the chat function, there was a separate chat function for people to ask questions of the TAs during the exam. It never stopped because people were worried about getting everything wrong in this digital exam in the way that they were confident with something that might have been happening in a paper exam. So it felt like it was very stressful for the people running the exams. It was stressful for the students, all kinds of logistical problems. If you're drawing diagrams, or if you have things which aren't just written text, how you have to get people to photograph that and upload it with their cameras. It just felt crazy. So what I was thinking about is there a way in which I can rethink the course so that I take out some of the uncertainty for students, and that I can have something which is rigorous and robust, but is more transparent and doesn't put the whole focus on this exam event, which seems to be driving some of the stuff around plagiarism and the communication about that. The other thing that influenced me was some feedback I had about a different course that I teach, which is a practical course, which is this structured practical where each week you do a different task and it builds up through a project week by week. And I had an excellent TA who talked to me about his experience of doing the course the year before. And if something goes wrong during that time, you find yourself a week behind, you don't have the product which is needed, and all of a sudden you're running to catch up, trying to solve the problems that you weren't able to do in the first week and get back on top of the game. Mm-hmm. And I realized that there's a danger again in the corona time, not just around getting things wrong or not understanding them, but my experience of the of being locked down and working from home is that I have good weeks and bad weeks, and luckily not too many bad weeks. But if you have a bad week in the middle of the block and you're behind, you're then catching up and you're running to catch up, and it's adding this stress into the system and taking out the learning. So I also wanted to have something which, from a student perspective, gave as much control and much flexibility for the student in how they approach the work. I would want them to keep delivering work regularly, but in a way that if they had a bad week and had to miss something, it wasn't catastrophic, and it didn't mean that the rest of the teaching block was going to be a write-off in terms of pressure. So that was kind of cooking in my head, and I read a blog article about something called specifications grading, which I hadn't heard of before. Mm-hmm. And it was somebody who's is an American maths professor, talking about his experience of how he designed courses and how he'd gone through a number of iterations and made mistakes, and talking about this process that he'd arrived in, which seemed to catch all of the problems and structure the course. And I read it and thought, yeah, I think I could structure the course material that I've got so that I'm working in this way. And given that I have no choice about Corona and no choice about teaching online, this might be the ideal opportunity to do something completely different in terms of the assessment and really integrate that into the working. So I decided to give it a go. And specifications grading, you could call it, I suppose, it's similar to continuous assessment, people might say, in terms of every, you know, there are people are collecting assessed pieces of work as they go through the course. The difference for me is that it's you don't accumulate a grade by saying, okay, somebody got 60 points on this and 80 points on that and 45 points on that and 23 points on that and adding it up. Mm-hmm. People, there is a standard that each piece of work has to reach. And your grade for that piece of work is either that it's a pass or it's revise and resubmit. So it's a bit like the academic process of submitting something to a journal. Mm-hmm. And there's no limit on how often people can submit a piece of work. They get feedback, qualitative feedback, on what they've done wrong and pointers about what they might have understood. And you can actually see from their mistakes what they haven't understood and have a conversation with them to help them improve. But they have to get it good enough to pass in order to pass. And I was thinking, you hear a lot about Zeschusskultur, and I think, the culture of getting a six and just doing enough to get by. Mm. I don't think that's hugely widespread. I think there might be some student societies or some students who think in that way. But you get this, you realize that to get a six, that's actually 55% rounds you up to a six. Somebody could kind of know about half of all of the course and pass at the end of the course. Now, they don't really know what they're doing. They don't really understand the theory, but they've done enough not to fail all the way through, and they get a pass. And I was also thinking, well, for my theory that I'm teaching, this approach, I would hate to have somebody who had learned it and then go to one of my colleagues in another university and not be able to do it and not know what they were talking about and had got this pass from this course I was teaching in Groningen. So I thought, okay, well, if you're going to get a six from knowing just about half of it, you could know just about half of all of it, or you could have a really thorough knowledge of half of it. And so to pass, there's this core of the theory, the bits that hang together, that I expect everybody to be able to deliver excellent work for the modules in those areas, in those topics, in order to get a passing grade. So in order to get a passing grade, you really have to know the core of the theory. And then if you want to, you can go further and explore things. But I expect people to be working really hard and demonstrating that they're understanding for that. And then if you've decided to optimize your workload to get a six, you do that by working very hard just for half the material rather than for all the material.
Right.
So that was part of it as well. So the idea is that a student will submit a piece of work, they'll pass or they'll revise and resubmit. And if they resubmit, they can resubmit as often as they like without penalty. But once you've passed, you know you've got that contribution to your grade. So maybe it's a little bit gamified. So you can see as you go through the block where you are with your grade, where you're going with the work. It's not like I need to get an 80 on this next piece of work in order to pass. You know how many pieces of work you have to pass to get it, and you know what the standard is. Yeah. So I decided to try that approach.
And so I know, so first of all, how many students were in your course?
So I was lucky. It was a really small course. I had 30 students sign up.
Okay, well, that's still a fair size.
Yeah, and because it's the first time I've taught it, and nobody else in Groningen works with this theory, I didn't have any TAs. So when I went to see the chair of the exam board and said, are you okay with me trying out this assessment? And I made the case and explained what I was going to do. He said, well, I can see how it works, but I think you're setting yourself up for a massive amount of work with the grading, and are you really sure that you want to do that? And that was a point at which I could have said, no, I'm just going to do it. But that was a point when I thought, well, in for a penny, in for a pound, I'll do it.
Yeah. So I know a lot of people would say, like, if they can resubmit as often as they want, doesn't that drastically increase your workload? Because you're continuously assessing, although that's wonderful for the students to be getting so much formative feedback and to be able to work toward mastery on a topic and not just say, I've done this part, I only got this grade, and now there's nothing I can do to improve, so I'll just move on without actually mastering it. So I love that they can resubmit, but how did you make it more manageable for yourself?
So first of all, in the course, there are 14 different units, and you needed seven of them to pass. This is one of the things I learned from the blog post. So first of all, I put an incentive in. So if you submitted a piece of work regularly, so in each week, if you submitted a piece of work, that contributed towards a participation grade. Mm-hmm. So there was this incentive to keep a regular rhythm, and there was a limit for students. So you could only submit two pieces of work in any 1 week. You couldn't submit more. So like you couldn't wait till the last week and submit 10 pieces of work and expect me to grade them all. You needed to submit two a week. And then I had this idea of get out of jail cards. So people had two opportunities, two things where either in the teaching block or in the 3 weeks of the exam block, they could play a get out of jail card and submit a third piece of work if they were really stuck. So I thought, you know, I was being super nice. And actually only two of those got used in the whole course. So I don't know how, but I think people liked the idea that they were there. And yeah. I certainly got emails about them, about using them, but then people managed to do the work. So I tried to structure it so that there was an upper limit of the number of pieces of work that will be coming through for grading in each week. But I really wanted the students to be getting through the modules early. And also you couldn't, so there were I can't remember the exact terms I used for them. So there were the core topics. There were the extension topics, which were looking at the theory in particular ways. And then there were some kind of core, advanced, and extension. And then these extension topics, which were kind of the leading edge of the theory that things are going on, that if students had completed the core and done a couple of the advanced topics, they could then go into an extension topic. So you had to complete one level before you could move to the next one. So people couldn't cherry pick and do the difficult stuff without doing the easy stuff underneath. So it was trying to give them a pathway of what they had to do.
Yeah, nice. Great strategy. Yeah. And then how did you assess the different assignments? Like, did you have scoring rubrics or other criteria that you gave them? Or like, how did you do the marking?
So it's a course in linguistic analysis. And so all of the assignments were based on language data from different languages that they had to analyze using the tools that they'd learned in the course material that week. Okay. And so there were a number of, so each assignment was in a number of sections looking at different areas. So people had to use the formalism correctly. They had to be able to apply the rules correctly. They needed to be in the right way. So as I would say, you're allowed a total of three mistakes in across two of the four sections. Mm-hmm. So I was expecting them to have very high standards. The assignments had the learning outcomes on them. It was clear about the standards in terms of the number of mistakes that they had to do, and they had to use the data. They did to analyze the data was there. Mm-hmm. The other thing that I did was after the first couple where people had learned the core basics, the students had to contribute data from their own language. So the course material isn't always in English. Teaching was in English, but I wanted them to think about a language that they knew that wasn't English and apply the tools that we've got in a different context. So to think about another language in that way. And they had to convince me that their analysis was right. So they needed to provide evidence and explain why it's this and not that. So it was really trying to get them actively engaged and thinking about applying the theory to these analyses.
Yeah, nice. And then did they submit their assignments through Nestor to you, or how did you structure that?
Yeah, they submit into Nestor. And what I would do is they'd submit it on PDF, and I would go through and I'd annotate the PDF and put that back into Nestor. And I'd put some comments on the side as well, just to explain what was going on. And particularly if somebody had needed to revise and resubmit, to say why, to say that they needed to look at the feedback, to explain what the theories was, to talk about the stuff that they'd understood and acknowledge that.
Right. And on average, how many times did people resubmit things?
Almost everybody had to resubmit once. There was one thing where the student just didn't get it. And I wonder whether I taught it, because everyone had a bit of a problem with it. But someone, I think she had five goes at the same assignment, but she got it. She got through and she got it. And that was great feeling for both of us, that actually she was able to deliver it and she could explain why and understand why she'd done it. So I think most people had to resubmit two or three assignments, and someone had multiple resubmissions.
And then in the end, how did it work out in terms of a grading load for you?
It was way too much. It was way too much. I'm not sure, for the first time that I've done it, that I could have had TAs, because I was also learning about the work. And now I've got a really thorough idea of how the assessments work. Mm-hmm. I know what I'm going to change about the assessments to make them work better. And I'm very, very clear about how I need to train the TAs in giving feedback and how to assess the work and how to support the learning of students in this different kind of way, rather than just going through and giving a grade. This is all about giving the qualitative feedback. So what can I do in terms of templates and patterns and helping them to do the error analysis and work out what the most useful feedback is?
Right. So you will do it again. It wasn't overwhelming to the point where you're like, nope.
So it was overwhelming. And a big chunk of that was the fact that it was a brand new course and just the work in getting the lectures ready and some of the teaching material. I had fantastic evaluations and I'm really pleased with that. That's why I want to teach. I want to not, it's not kind of an ego thing, but the, so I've just got to open on my screen. So I'm just looking forward at the screen. Someone said, yeah, I love this current course. It felt like my goal was to learn rather than to get a good or a passing grade.
Nice.
And he said, I really enjoyed how this course made for constant communication between the student and the teacher, made for a fruitful and enjoyable learning experience.
Yeah. And in both of those, the key word is learning. Yeah.
You know, that's why I want to do this. I work best with students who want to learn. And some of that motivation comes from the student themselves, but some of it comes from the environment that you put them in. And I think if you can find a way to hook the enthusiasm, then maybe you get something which is more productive out of it. You know, maybe I'm being naive and blue-eyed, maybe in 3 years it'll all have worn off. But I was really, really pleased that kind of they got it, that they got this, that this is what they wanted to do.
Yeah, awesome. So you felt good at the end, even though it did probably feel overwhelming at certain points. The students were pleased with it overall in the evaluations. What will you change for next time, aside from having TAs helping you?
So what I didn't have time to do this year is I want to do more short explainer videos. So I want things that I can refer students back to with different ways of explaining the same topic. There's more than one way that you can explain things. And so I want to put together short things with particularly the points that prove to be difficult around how the theory works and some of the assumptions of the theory. I want to get some explainers so that I have these video resources alongside the readings that students have and the discussion in the lectures. The lecturing that I did was probably pretty traditional. So I did we had the standard lecture time and I delivered the lecture online. People should have done some reading beforehand, but it wasn't built in the same way to the learning. I broke up the lectures with quizzes. So about what was going on, but I could structure that more. I could do more polling. I could certainly do more discussion among the students. And So somebody asked, there were two requests from students. One of them was, you know, could they have group projects? And the other one was, could they do some coding? Because it felt like it was a very formal approach. And in other language courses with formal approach they'd had, they were able to do some coding. That could be possible. I need to think about how they do it. But one way I could do it is I could get a group of three or four students, all of whom are looking at a different other language to English, and get them to work together on some of the coding aspects and peer critique their code as to how they're analyzing the language. So they're not just convincing me about how their language works, mm-hmm. they're having to convince their peers and to use those groups maybe as the discussion groups in lectures for checking out knowledge of some of the theoretical concepts as we go along. And the lecture that I went to last night where I can't remember his name, is it Wyman, the Nobel Prize winner, who was talking about this idea of you start a lecture with a quiz on a reading, you get people to discuss their answers and re-poll before you tell them what the answer is. I could see that working very well in this context if you have the groups and if you have a structure to do that. So that's something that I would be interested in doing and trying. It's maybe a bit more social learning in there, and that idea that they're not just convincing me, they need to be arguing with their peers about why, you know, their decision, their story about how Dutch works. Okay, sell it to somebody whose first language is French, sell it to somebody whose first language is Armenian, and let's see how we get on.
Yeah, nice. I love that you're really modeling the exact same thing that you're doing with them. So that to me is when your message and your method match, then you have integrity. So I love that you're doing that you're giving them feedback and allowing them to resubmit on their assignments and the way you structure your course. And then you're listening to their evaluations and then you're revising your course based on their feedback. So I love that it's happening on both sides. That's really nice.
Yeah. So I came into academia late. I did my bachelor's degree a long, long time ago in something that wasn't linguistics. And I worked as a manager in the UK Health Service for nearly 25 years. And in the health service, you cannot move for feedback. You're always getting stuff on the impact of your performance. You're having 360 degree appraisals on your personal impact. If you're in a leadership position, there is loads and loads of feedback. And then in the university situation, there's very, very little. And my problem is that in that vacuum, I have no idea how I'm doing. And there's this danger that either I think everything is perfect or I lose confidence and think everything is terrible. And so one of the things that I had, which I hope will work better, is I had a Google, just a quick Google form at the end of every lecture where I ask for, tell me something that worked well about the lecture, tell me something that I could do differently or think about. In a physical room, I give everybody stickies when they come in and they have a red sticky and a green sticky. They write it on, it's anonymous. You stick it by the door on the way out. But I need that feedback and I need something to work with to think about how am I going to do this differently. So the student voice is really important to me.
Awesome. Yeah. And it sounds like you got some really nice ideas from your students of how to improve it. And I think you and I were having a conversation earlier about none of us are experts right now in pandemic teaching because we're all trying to figure it out as we go. So our students are partners in that, and it's so important to hear their perspective and to use their ideas of what's going to help them. Like you started talking about at the very beginning today, having empathy for them. It's not easy when they're taking multiple courses and watching hours of online lectures per day and struggling maybe personally and socially with other things outside of their academic studies. So important to keep all of those things in mind and let them know that their voice is valued.
Yeah.
And definitely heard.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, one of the things I did right at the start, I mean, that hit, knowing that they're going to be heard, I felt to me to be really important. And also with the revise and resubmit, I needed them to be able to access me as the teaching team, in a team of one, without feeling as it was going to be a big thing. And I have this sense that it's easy to ask a question, to hang around at the end of a lecture, to have a longer conversation rather than ask a lecture. It's easier to do that than to email somebody to ask for a one-to-one meeting. And I found that, you know, with my own relationships with people in the team, if you can knock on someone's door and lean in the doorway and talk to them, it's easy. Asking to book a Google Meet is just an extra threshold. So at the very start, again, it was a small class, but I had a 10-minute video conversation with everybody. So I said that I needed to talk to them one-to-one, and that was partly to, so I knew how their faces were, because I guessed that I wouldn't be seeing a lot of faces in the lectures. But I also wanted to ask, was there anything that I needed to take into account in terms of their home situation for online learning, any problems in terms of the communication, and to emphasize that they shouldn't feel that it was a high threshold to have to talk to me. And they found it a bit odd. Some of them found it a bit odd. Some of them loved it. I'm really grateful that they were willing to sign up and have the conversation with me.
Did all of them do it?
Yeah, they all did it.
Wow, that's awesome.
Yeah, it's really odd. So at the beginning, they'd never met me before. They didn't know what it was. So I think they thought it was some kind of course requirement. But yeah, everybody signed up. And so that was good. And you find out, yeah, somebody's stuck in Portugal and can't get back. Okay. Good to know. This is how we're doing. So me telling you about stuff which is available in the UB, if you can do this, isn't going to help you. So again, really try at the start, trying to emphasize the communicative aspect of it and the fact that in terms of the learning and in terms of the corona, we're in this together and we have to find some kind of solutions and try. So think of almost like a facilitating resource rather than a top-down teaching resource.
Yeah. And we've talked about it, and I talk with a lot of teachers about it, like how we need to work to find ways to humanize our teaching right now. So it's not just, you know, a radio broadcaster or a YouTube channel in your course where there isn't any kind of human connection. So that's a really nice way of doing it before your course even starts, to have these little meetings with everyone so they feel comfortable with you.
Yeah.
You're a human. Yeah.
I love talking to people. I get energy from talking to people, and I get ideas from talking to people. The fact that you're giving qualitative feedback turns it into a conversation. Mm-hmm. It's not a series of submission and return. It felt to me like much more of a conversation. What I realize is I love giving feedback. I hate grading. And this was a really neat way for me to give feedback and have some kind of quality assessment without wasting time thinking, is this person 7 the same as that person 7, and all that kind of stuff around fairness, mm-hmm. which can take a lot of headspace and a lot of time.
Yeah. And I love the fact that, like, they're coming up with their own sentences in their own language and things like that for analysis. Now there's not going to be any issue at all with fraud or cheating.
So I wrote a script so that everybody got an individualized assessment. So I had for the examples, I drew things out of a set of English sentences. So if they had to analyze one section, they had to analyze 5 sentences. That was drawn out of a pool and it was randomized. So not everybody had exactly the same thing. But yes, then they had to generate their own stuff. So yeah, it has to be unique. And it's really easy to spot if 2 people have come up with the same sentence.
Mm-hmm. So now that you've done this once with this course, do you have other courses you'd like to redesign for the future?
So I have another course, a master's level course, which is looking at different kinds of syntactic theories and thinking about how they might be applied to cognitive modeling, that I will be preparing for block 2B, so 2022. And then the insights from this, it's not quite the same, but I want to use aspects of this in that course. I think it requires much more reflection of them. So they're not demonstrating the skills, but they need to be able to demonstrate that they understand what's going on in the different theories and they can explain the differences between them. So that's where I need to think about what are the assessment tools that can do that. But the idea of this idea of the of specifications grading, I do like. It feels like it gets the focus on the learning, not the number.
Yeah, and it's not just something you would do in an online setting, but you could also use it when you go back to physical classrooms, which hopefully we will by 2022. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, nice. Have you talked to very many colleagues about this new way of doing things and shared your excitement about it, or have you had a chance to have dialogue with anyone?
Not really. I mean, there haven't really been the forums to do it. But, I'm talking to you about it. Maybe people will see this. If people want to find out more about it, I'm really, really happy to talk about it and to talk about what I learned and what worked and what didn't work.
Fantastic. Yeah, well, be prepared, maybe.
yeah, it'd be great, you know.
But it's certainly wonderful that you're willing to share it here. Thank you for being willing to talk about your teaching. So
really happy. Thank you for inviting me. It's great to have a venue to kind of reflect in public.
Educational Support and Innovation, or ESI, is the central instructional support team for all educators at the University of Groningen. To find out more about the services and resources we have made available during this interesting time in the world and in academic education, please visit edusupport.ruch.nl.